Magnum Berkeley Audio presents High Fidelity by Nick Hornby. Read by David Cale. My Desert Island all-time top five most memorable split-ups in chronological order. 1. Alison Ashworth. 2. Penny Hardwick. 3. Jackie Allen. 4. Charlie Nicholson. 5. Sarah Kendrew. These were the ones that really hurt. Can you see your name in that lot, Laura? I reckon you'd sneak into the top 10, but there's no place for you in the top 5. Those places are reserved for the kind of humiliations and heartbreaks that you're just not capable of delivering. That probably sounds crueler than it's meant to, but the fact is we're too old to make each other miserable. And that's a good thing, not a bad thing. So don't take your failure to make the list personally. Those days are gone, and good fucking riddance to them. Unhappiness really meant something back then. Now it's just a drag, like a cold or having no money. If you really wanted to mess me up, you should have got to me earlier. 1. Alison Ashworth, 1972. Most nights we used to mess around in the park around the corner from my house. I lived in Hertfordshire, but I might just as well have lived in any suburb in England. It was that sort of suburb and that sort of park, 3 minutes away from home, right across the road from a little row of shops. We were 12 or 13 and had recently discovered irony. Or at least, what I later understood to be irony. We only allowed ourselves to play on the swings and the roundabout and the other kids' stuff rusting away in there if we could do it with a sort of self-conscious, ironic detachment. This involved either an imitation of absent-mindedness, whistling or chatting or fiddling with a cigarette stub or a box of matches usually did the trick, or a flirtation with danger. So we jumped off the swings when they could go no higher, jumped onto the roundabout when it could go no faster, hung on to the end of the swing boat until it reached an almost vertical position. If you could somehow prove that these childish entertainments had the potential to dash your brains out, then playing on them became okay somehow. We had no irony when it came to girls, though. There was just no time to develop it. One moment they weren't there, not in any form that interested us anyway, and the next you couldn't miss them. They were everywhere. All over the place. One moment you wanted to clonk them on the head for being your sister or someone else's sister, and the next you wanted to... Actually, we didn't know what we wanted next, but it was something. Something. Almost overnight, all these sisters, there was no other kind of girl, not yet, had become interesting, disturbing even. I started going out with one of them. No, that's not right. Because I had absolutely no input into the decision-making process. And I can't say that she started going out with me either. It's that phrase, going out with, that's the problem. Because it suggests some sort of parity and equality. What happened was that David Ashworth's sister, Alison, peeled off from the female pack that gathered every night by the bench and adopted me, tucked me under her arm, and led me away from the swing boat. I can't remember now how she did this. I don't think I was even aware of it at the time, because halfway through our first kiss, my first kiss, I can remember feeling utterly bewildered, totally unable to explain how Alison Ashworth and I had become so intimate. I wasn't even sure how I'd ended up on her side of the park, away from her brother and Mark Godfrey and the rest, nor how we had separated from her crowd, nor why she tipped her face towards me so that I knew I was supposed to put my mouth on hers. The whole episode defies any rational explanation, but all these things happened, and they happened again, most of them, the following evening, and the evening after that. So what was the significance of the snog? The truth is that there was no significance. We were just lost in the dark. One part imitation. People I had seen kissing by 1972. James Bond, Simon Templar, Napoleon Solo, Barbara Windsor, and Sid James. or maybe Jim Dale, Elsie Tanner, Omar Sharif and Julie Christie, Elvis, and lots of black and white people my mum wanted to watch, although that they never waggled their heads from side to side. To one part hormonal slavery, to one part peer group pressure. Kevin Bannister and Elizabeth Barnes had been at it for a couple of weeks. To one part blind panic. There was no consciousness, no desire and no pleasure beyond an unfamiliar and moderately pleasant warmth in the gut. We were little animals, which is not to imply that by the end of the week we were tearing our tank tops off. Just that, metaphorically speaking, we had begun to sniff each other's bottoms and we did not find the odour entirely repellent. But listen, Laura. On the fourth night of our relationship, I turned up in the park and Alison was sitting on the bench with her arm around Kevin Bannister, with Elizabeth Barnes nowhere in sight. Nobody, not Alison or Kevin or me, or the sexually uninitiated retards hanging off the end of the swingboat, said anything at all. I stung and I blushed, and I suddenly forgot how to walk without being aware of every single part of my body. And that was that. Where had I gone wrong? First night, park, fag, snog. Second night, ditto. Third night, ditto. Fourth night, chucked. Okay, maybe I should have seen the signs. Maybe I was asking for it. Round about that second ditto, I should have spotted that we were in a rut, that I had allowed things to fester to the extent that she was on the lookout for someone else. But she could have tried to tell me. She could at least have given me another couple of days to put things right. My relationship with Alison Ashworth had lasted 6 hours, so I could hardly claim that I'd got used to having her around, that I didn't know what to do with myself. In fact, I can hardly recall anything about her at all now. But there still seems to be an element of that evening in everything that has happened to me since. All my other romantic stories seem to be a scrambled version of that first one. 2. Penny Hardwick, 1973. Penny Hardwick was a nice girl, and nowadays I'm all for nice girls. Although then, I wasn't so sure. She had a nice mum and dad, and a nice house, detached with a garden and a tree and a fish pond, and a nice girl's haircut. She was blonde, and kept her hair a sort of sporty, clean, wholesome form captain mid-length. A nice, smiling eyes, and a nice younger sister who smiled politely when I rang the doorbell, and kept out of the way when we wanted her to. She had nice manners. My mum loved her. And she always got nice school reports. Penny was nice looking. And her top five recording artists were Carly Simon, Carole King, James Taylor, Cat Stevens and Elton John. Lots of people liked her. She was so nice, in fact, that she wouldn't let me put my hand underneath or even on top of her bra. And so I was finished with her. Although, obviously, I didn't tell her why. She cried, and I hated her for it, because she made me feel bad. I can imagine what sort of person Penny Hardwick became. A nice person. I know that she went to college, did well, and landed a job as a radio producer for the BBC. I would guess that she is bright and serious-minded, perhaps too much so sometimes, and ambitious, but not in a way that makes you want to vomit. She was a version of all these things when we went out. And at another stage in my life, I would have found all these virtues attractive. Then, however, I wasn't interested in qualities, just breasts. And she was therefore no good to me. We went to the pictures, to parties and to discos, and we wrestled. We wrestled in her bedroom, and my bedroom, and her living room, and my living room. And in bedrooms at parties, and in living rooms at parties, and in the summer we wrestled on various plots of grass. We were wrestling over the same old issue. Sometimes I got so bored of trying to touch her breasts that I would try to touch between her legs, a gesture that had a sort of self-parodying wit about it. It was like trying to borrow a fiver, getting turned down, and asking to borrow 50 quid instead. These were the questions boys asked other boys at my school, a school that contained only boys. Are you getting any? Does she let you have any? How much does she let you have? And so on. Sometimes the questions would derive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.